Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm Guan Xiaolan from CNKI International. On behalf of all hosts of International Association of University Libraries, IATUL, Tsinghua University Library, the University of Hong Kong Libraries, and CNKI, I would like to welcome all of you to 2022 WAL Spotlight Competence Development Program. WAL Spotlight aims to invite those librarians who have outstanding experience in library services innovation to give online lectures and share their best practice, case analysis, and research results from their real work. Today is the second lecture. We feel very honored to have Dr. J.K. Vijayakumar as our distinguished speaker for May. Dr. Vijay carries 22 years of leadership experience in higher education libraries, scholarly communication, and research. He has been serving COST since 2009 in various portfolios of the University Library Director, Manager of Research and Information Services, Senior Subject Specialist, and currently as Strategic Information Advisor. He was instrumental in successfully leading several open access initiatives at COST and collaborated with international programs, including OA 2020. He served on the board of directors at the International Association of University Libraries, IATUL, representing the Middle East, also on various standing committees of IFLA, publishers, library advisory boards, and editorial boards of reputed journals. He was the Associated Library Director at the American University of Antigua in West Indies and a Scientific Officer at the University's Grants Commission Information and Library Network Center in India. We all know that libraries are the places of learning and knowledge creation. Over the last two decades, digital technology and the changes that came with it have accelerated this transformation to a point where evolution starts to become a revolution. The wider open science movement and the open access in particular is one of these changes and already having a profound impact. In a world where all research is open, the role of the library is shifting from licensing and disseminating to facilitating and supporting the publishing process itself. How will research libraries act during such an open research environment, and how librarians perform during the research life cycle? I believe all of us are very eager to know the right answer. Ladies and gentlemen, now let's invite Dr. Vijay to deliver the speech, Institutional Strategies for Open Science and Open Access, Librarians' Role. Dr. Vijay, welcome.
Thank you, Nancy. Can you hear me well?
Yes, no problem.
Can you see the slides?
I think it's a coming on the way.
Okay, I think I, 1 second. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. It's okay now?
Yeah, no problem, sir.
Okay, thank you, thank you. So thank you, China National Knowledge Infrastructure CNKI team, and especially Nancy, for inviting me for this session. And thank you everyone for joining us from around the globe on today's session. And I also want to thank Tsinghua University Library and University of Hong Kong Libraries for their collaboration. And I want to acknowledge CNKI's longstanding collaborative efforts with my association, IATUL, in professional attributes. So with that words, let me go to my presentation. So today, through this presentation, I will put forward some thoughts and strategies for research institutions and libraries in enlarging their comprehensiveness in open access, open science, and open research environment. So structure of the talk will be 30 minutes. I'll be speaking based on some slides. And at the end, we will have 10 minutes for question and answer sessions. So open science or open research, why it is important and why everyone is talking about it. It is a fact that reproducibility of science, a fundamental principle in scientific research, it remains one of the challenges even after decades of our efforts in open access. Validating a research method can be demanding and can only be achieved if independent researchers can replicate the results. Increased quality and impact can also be achieved when sharing research work as it exposes results to open scrutiny and allows third parties to verify and validate the conclusions. Transparency in evaluation also strives for an open evaluation and rigorous peer review, which relies upon values of indisputable evidence, intellectual and ethical rigor, and credibility. When we describe the elements of open science or open research, just imagine having an open environment in all stages of a research life cycle, whether it is a scientific research or social science research, not just at the publishing stage. It may start with a pre-registration of research proposal or a report to start with, sharing the reading list while doing the literature review, or using open lab notebooks to record the lab work, use open source software or open infrastructure to conduct the research and analysis, preserving and sharing the research data published or unpublished, deposit preprint versions, and also practice open access while publishing, producing and using open educational resources, supporting the citizen science, implementing open alternate open evaluation process. Everything together make the research or science more and more open. So to achieve this, open access to the research output is simply not enough. We must bring open practices to entire life cycle of research, not just at the dissemination of results. So that is where open science or open research is going to play a revolutionary role, as Nancy was mentioning. So little more about open science. European Union has taken a leadership role, and then UNESCO recently adopted open science guidelines. OECD is working with member and non-member economies to review policies to promote open science and to assess their impact on research and innovation. There are many countries, for example, see the USA National Academies of Science, Engineering and Medicine has published a report on open science by design. For example, India is also revising its science and technology policy to include open science practice as a default. So you can see many such examples from different countries. UNESCO open science and recommendation is around four main components. Briefly, open scientific knowledge that represent the published research output, but not just the journal articles. It includes research data, OER, et cetera, in this category. Open science infrastructure, both virtual and physical. Open community engagements, where citizen science, open scientific communication, et cetera, playing a role. Then open dialogue with other knowledge systems aims to promote the inclusion of knowledge from traditionally marginalized scholars and enhance their interrelationship to upgrade the science into more, to reach more wider communities. I also want to briefly touch upon what libraries' role in research lifecycle and how this can be helpful for open science. So if you see the research life cycle, these all are the various components of a research life cycle. And typically research libraries helping in all areas of this research life cycle, helping their institutions, helping their research community, whether it is preparation side, whether it is gathering side, whether it is doing the research, whether it is publishing or when it is being preserved, even when their research results are measured libraries provide tools and systems in all components. I'm not going to explain because I'm talking to librarians. And research libraries or academic libraries strategically, proactively find opportunities and embed themselves into various research lifecycle areas. And how do we bring open science into this research lifecycle? You may see it as a simple thing, but there are a lot of things to be done. But simply, it's embedding openness as a default in whatever you are doing, whatever you are supporting your research community. So that is where libraries' role in a big, if I try to give you a big picture, this is how I'm seeing libraries playing the role in bringing open science culture into the entire research lifecycle. So let me talk about open access, which is one part of the open science. I just want to show two initiatives. One is Library Publishing Coalition Initiative and OIA 2020 initiative. The library publishing model is a community-led scholarly communication ecosystem to better serve their parent institutions, faculty, and also the common good. While each library publishing program differs in its structure, goals, and focus, these programs typically build on the skills of librarians in scholarship, metadata, publishing, and also align with the values of their institutions, prioritizing open access and open source software and new emerging publication types. So this image shows its reach so far. This image and report are also available from the website, from Library Publishing Coalition website. So it's getting a momentum. Another model, OIA 2020, came through planners mainly in Europe, aims to transform the subscription model to publishing model, or the flip model, whatever model we call. You can see from this image already a number of first mover national licensing consortia are approaching approximately 70 to 80% of their corresponding author papers published immediately open access, largely through the successful negotiation and implementation of transformative agreements. And newcomers are also rapidly making their entry and bringing up the engagements. So the transformative open access initiative, which is gaining momentum via OIA 2020, in which my organization was also strategically taking a part since 2017. So this image you can see coming up from ISAC registry, where all the institutions or consortia are supposed to register their transformative agreements. So maybe all transformative agreements are not registered there. So this image may not be an accurate one, but it's an indicative one. You can clearly see the top left, Sweden. You can see the gray area. It's typically around 20% of the total published research output is still under hybrid, but you can see 80% is open through various approaches. And you can see in this image, you know, it's coming down where the gray color increase means you are more published research output still behind the paywall. So this is how, you know, various countries are approaching. So a combination of these two models for me, especially going to strengthen the transformation in open access publishing. I also want to briefly touch upon the Spark. One of their survey, they Spark conducted a survey of its membership on this early 2021 about COVID related budget cuts. And of the libraries facing cuts in US and Canada, they are, you know, saving money from their library budget through unbundling and from the big packages, moving away from the big packages and saving that money and utilizing that library budget to support open access infrastructure, open access programs, OER programs, open access publishing, read and publishing, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the latest strategy you can see on the image on the right side. You can see their strategies are typically focusing on international digitization efforts, supporting OER adoption, supporting OER creation, supporting open access publishing, investment in open access infrastructure, library publishing. So you can see how North American libraries are, you know, channelizing their budget towards open science and open access environments. You can also have a look at Spark big deal tracker, where they record all the, you know, unbundling exercises, moving away from big deals, and you know, going only for the relevant journals what that institution needed. Two examples are here from Virginia Tech and the State University of New York system. They saved a lot of money from the library budget by moving away from big deals. Then using that money towards you know, open access and open science efforts. Let me also speak about the open access framework, which we are following based on planners. If we aim to achieve 100% open access according to your institution or national circumstances, we can adopt a combination of three routes mainly. Yeah, and we have been following this model. Route two is the green route, institutional repository route, one of my favorite route. We must strengthen our institutional repository by adopting institutional open access policies and also providing all possible value-added services to enhance the comprehensiveness in submission and increasing the visibility of the submitted research. Route one is the gold route where institutions can negotiate institutional publishing agreements to reduce the spending and manage the payments at the institutional level to save the time of the researchers. In route three, to avoid double dipping in the hybrid model, you can negotiate transformative deals or institutional agreements with a combination of subscription and publishing rights to your institution. We must find ways to convert our subscription spend to support the publishing spend of the institution. So there are initiatives to strengthen global open access infrastructure, and you must find a way to support them, like we support Archive, DOAJ, DOAB, et cetera. So with open access, I also just want to make sure where researchers are typically playing, taking some actions in open access. So about the version of the record, you know, when it is published, you have preprint, you have accepted version, that's called the postprint, then also the final version. So in each area, usually researchers take actions. For example, they may submit their research work to self-archive. They have been doing it. They can post it to institutional repository, in your institutional repository or a global institutional repository. They also pay article processing charge to the journals and get their work published. I want to emphasize that any organization or a library can strategically support all these OA actions by the researchers. We can spend a smaller portion of your budget to financially support global OA infrastructure, like preprint server. We can strengthen our institutional repository through adopting open access mandate and comprehensiveness. For example, we were able to get 82% of published papers deposited in our repository in 2020-21 period through two different approaches. We can also negotiate transformative deals or institutional agreements for hybrid journals with a combination of subscription and publishing rights. So let me tell you, this is a new role for librarians, probably, and also for institutions. A new service, new data, new procedures, new workflow. I see it as a transformation to our own work in supporting scholarly communication, open access, and open science. So for us, in COUST, we were able to secure 16 transformative agreements, and we were able to support 30% of the published outputs covered through this, you know, transformative agreements. So any institutions can work towards that. Let me also speak about how this OA transformation is happening globally. So this image from Scopus database showing the highly contributing countries to the research output. So China is number one, then US, then countries like UK, Germany, India are on the top, you know, in terms of number of research publications in the world. So they are the biggest, you know, contributors to the research output in the world. Now, let us look at the another image where it shows, sorry, Can you see the image? I have some difficulty here. Can you see the image completely, Nancy?
Yes, Vijay, no problem.
Okay, sure, thank you. So the second image, OA availability in percentage 2018 to 2021, this data is taken from SciWorld, based on unpaywall data. You can clearly see the countries in Europe taking actually a lead. Some countries even have 70% of their research output available open access through various modes. It could be on a repository, it could be on a gold journal, it could be on a hybrid journal through transformative agreements. But 70% for Netherlands, 70% of their research output is openly available during 2018-2021. So most of the European countries are on the top in terms of OA availability. And countries coming from US or even from Middle East, like Saudi Arabia and Qatar, are also following that trend. But you can see countries in Asia are, you know, kind of lagging behind, where, of course, institutions and libraries can play a good role in improving the OA availability to their research output from their institutions through various combinations. Now, I also just want to briefly mention, you know, some individual institutions, you know, playing, taking a leading role in this, mainly most of them, again, coming from the Europe. Then I also want to, one university, TU Delft, I just saw this slide, this image 2 days ago on LinkedIn, claiming that 85% of their research output is openly available in 2021. So this is how institutions are doing, and definitely, you know, this is achieved the great involvement and support by the libraries. Let me also put some early thoughts on how this is going to be measured, how library collections or library success is going to be measured. Usually we measure our collection and success based on number of papers downloaded, and then we calculate the cost per use and we negotiate, right? So is it going to continue in that way, or are we going to be measured based on how many numbers of papers the libraries are supporting in OA publishing, or percentage of OA articles published through libraries OA agreement and collection budget, transformative deals? Would faculty expectations about the library collection will change? It already changed from holding to access, right? You know, we used to go to library to access the journals, the print ones, and also the archives. But now everything is online, so it went to access. Is it going to be changed, access to publish? So faculty and researchers will look library as an avenue to get support in publishing their research output than accessing to the published research output. How are we going to negotiate? Are we going to negotiate more on our access rights or publishing rights? And also another important thing globally, thinking, how do we balance the cost between research intensive institutions where they will be publishing more, so cost will be more than where less publishing organizations, how do we balance? And also how do we balance the cost between developed nations and less developed nations where research publishing is happening? So these all are some early thoughts. I may not have an answer to this. This is something as librarians we must start thinking about. Now coming to a little bit about open science. I think I'm doing good in time. I may have 10 more minutes probably. So in terms of open science, I would say strong leadership is needed to drive the change and support policies. Many of us may already have open access policies or research data management policies by now, or are in the process of making them. But the difference is open science or open research policies may not be the same like open access or research data management policies. Why? Because what I see from Europe and other countries, these are coming as government policies, which institutions to follow. So it may be more powerful. In terms of services and infrastructure, many of our organizations have done a good job in open access, maybe starting with RDM services and institutional infrastructure as well. So building an open science culture and making research default open, lots of training and awareness is required, where again librarians can play a good role. Then in terms of assessment and funding practices also need to change in open access environment. So there are lots of activities in this area that are happening to revise the existing practices without diluting the quality of research or science. In relation to this, I also want to briefly touch upon the new scholarly record. I'm sure you might have seen this image. It came from OCLC several years ago. So usually scholarly record was part of largely as defined as a formally published monographic or journal literature, but now it's changed. All our metrics, including alt metrics, is about the productivity, usage, and impact published record, including research data. Now, a scholarly record is evolved into a corpus of material and actions from the entire research lifecycle, more specifically, before and after publishing of a research work. It is included in the new scholarly record. Then how libraries are going to make sure the entire scholarly record is preserved and available to the people. I just want to show one example from Kaust repository. This image is coming from our repository, which typically evolved from just an abstract and full text record, now covering various components of research and actions by researchers, and many more stages needs to be included. So libraries have to play a good role in preserving the research, plus adding all the actions before the research and after the research into the scholarly record, and having a comprehensive and holistic view of the research conducted in our own institution. Then something about reviewing research assessment, a recommendation from UNESCO, considering that a commitment to open science requires time, resource, and efforts that cannot be automatically converted into traditional academic output, such as publications, but which can have a significant impact on science and society. Evaluation systems should take into account a wide breadth of missions within the knowledge creation environment. These missions come with more different forms of knowledge creation and communication, not just limited to the publishing in peer-reviewed international journals. So this is a recent recommendation from UNESCO on how institutions or funding agencies or governments are going to evaluate the research, and how institutions have to be get ready, and what support libraries can provide in this area is also something coming up. And as I mentioned just now, there are many countries changing, the evaluation systems. One example is result of a recently held library by European University Association, and it reveals 91% of the universities in the Europe has either adopted or soon adopting open science policies, and more than 60% of them use open science practices in their assessment and research evaluation. So this is happening, and we need to be getting ready for that. I'm also sure this other mandates from Leiden Manifesto, San Francisco Declaration. I'm not going to explain them. These all are working towards changing the way how we evaluate the research. Most recently, more than 300 EU organizations get closer to a consensus or research assessment reform. So this is very recent, 16th May, this came out. Now, the last part of my talk, what is the role of libraries or librarians? So the librarian's role will be most as enablers in this area. Libraries have adapted their role and are now active in the preservation, curation, publication, dissemination of digital scientific materials in the form of publications, data, and other research-related content. Libraries and repositories constitute the physical infrastructure that allows scientists to share, use, and reuse the outcome of their work. And they have been essential in creation of the open science movement. This is what OECD have noticed. So whatever libraries have done in this area is going to be useful, and we have to do more in getting into open science movement. So most of the library's role will be advocating, rising awareness, giving support to infrastructure, research data management, training, and supporting researchers in these areas. So to do that, what are the skill sets librarians need? So open science skills for librarians and research. I just want to bring two images coming from Libr. You can go to the website and have a read. You can have more ideas. So the Libr says, you know, in terms of FAIR data or metrics rewards, scholarly publishing, research integrity, citizen science are related to open science. Librarians can have, you know, skills like digital content creation, communication collaboration, information data literacy. All these skill sets are going to be useful. I also looked at another document, which is recently published through a workshop by Library of Medicine USA. They clearly mentioning developing the librarian workforce for data science and open science. Librarians have to upskill with the data skills, which includes data management plans, data and metadata standards, data sharing and reuse, data citation. Then computational skills, may not be everyone, but people are going to be real open science librarians or data science librarians need to develop their skills in computational, in data visualization or database design, etc. Then research and subject matter knowledge. If you are going to be specializing a data scientist in certain fields, then probably, you know, you may need to know more about how research is being conducted in that field, etc. Then traditional library skills like consultations, metadata, literature searching, our knowledge in scholarly communication, our knowledge in bibliometrics, especially in assessment and evaluation, is going to be useful. Then skills for developing programs and service. So we have to be developing new services to the community through this. So we need to have that skill to develop new programs, new services. Then definitely interpersonal skills and skills for lifelong learning. So these are, in a nutshell, what is recommended by this workshop. And this is very, I'm sure this is very clear to all of us. We have to, if you are going to work into, you know, open science or data science areas, librarians need to upskill certain skill sets from this array of skill sets required. So this is my last slide before I end. I'm sure you know that there was a submit very recently held, Quad Summit of the, you know, world leaders from many countries came together. And this was one of the news I just read it in White House, which is 2 days ago, 24th May, saying, talking about their importance. Quad partners will strengthen their commitment to free, full, and open sharing of space-based civil earth observation data. So it's very subject specific, but what they say is, and we'll jointly develop and promote the concept of open science in the region and globally. So it is politically, you know, at global leadership level, open science is being discussed and recommended widely and very importantly. So this is something all institutions have to follow. So when it comes to institutions, how open science environment can be built in our organization. Typically, you know, libraries will have a role to play. Library have been playing a role. You know, we were very strong enough in getting into scholarly communication and supporting and bringing the open access concept and culture into our own organizations, building infrastructure for that. Definitely, we have to do more in bringing the open science concept into our own organizations. I just want to show you two images as my last slides. As Charles Darwin said, it is not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change will survive. If you are not familiar with Dr. Saranganathan, he was a library scientist from India, but his five laws are very famous. And his fifth law clearly says the library is a growing organism. So it means a lot. It means we can also grow into, you know, in services and infrastructure and developing our skills. So this is my last slide. And again, once again, thank you very much for joining me today. Thank you, CNKI, and all the collaborating universities from China and Hong Kong, supporting my association, IATUL, in professional development. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay. I would like to express our appreciation for your most inspirative report. Indeed, the open research brings the challenges to the library colleagues, but also the opportunity for further innovative transformation in the meantime. Thank you, Dr. Vijay. Our participants have already left their questions for you. The first question is, to cope with the challenges of open world, so what more expertise and techniques librarians should concern about? I think you already mentioned this in the report, so can you share more details and maybe how it is conducted in cost library maybe?
Yeah, that's a good question. So there are many ways to do that. I think I heard a few slides about what all are the new skill sets need to be developed. So based on your institutional requirement, what exactly you are going to do, some of your library staff must be, happy to do that, so you can get them training. There are training opportunities available. So my advice is join some of the international initiatives. Like we are members of Digital Curation Center, DCC. We are a member of RDA, Research Data Alliance. We are a member of Spark. You don't need to be a member, but you can see what they are offering, get trained on those. Then if you want to go very specifically, for example, if you want to strengthen your expertise in data science, for example, there are a lot of training programs, and also there are a lot of MOOCs available from various institutions. So it depends on what you want to achieve, what you want to contribute, you can definitely build. But I typically mentioned almost all the skill sets in the slides. I don't want to repeat them at this point.
Okay, thanks, Dr. Vijay. And second question is, from the view of a library management, so how to enhance the efficiency of collaboration internally to start the open initiative?
Yeah, so that's a good question. I will just give you one example and one experience what we had here is. So we have a very successful research repository, so that made our community submitting their work into the repository. But we also consult with faculty members who typically using this open science environment knowingly or unknowingly. For example, they must be sharing their preprint, they must be sharing their research data already. So through the consultations, we start that engagement and find out what exactly they need more. So for example, one of the requirement came from the faculty members was, we need to have a DOI registered for our research data sets. So that came as a need, and we joined a data site as an institutional member. Now through the repository, we are able to provide DOIs to all the research data sets from the university. So that was an initiative and engagement. Now everyone can come to us for the DOI. So that is how it always happens, mainly through the discussions, mainly through the engagement, because you are serving a community, research community. You need to know what exactly they need and respond to. That is the responsive to change. Another example, how do you build the stakeholders, support? For example, when we are talking about read and publish agreements, transformative agreements, this may not be something very important for the researchers, because researchers are there to do their research. Okay, so how do we let them know why it is important? Mm-hmm. So when we talk about read and publish agreements, especially with our some of the leaders, they said, okay, this is something happening, it's good, go ahead. But one of the leader of our university who got public, who continuously publish, so he got an open access publishing without payment because it was covered in our transformative deals. That's the time he contacted us and said, oh, you're doing a great thing. I was not knowing actually what exactly it means. So the library's role in supporting research publishing, they will understand when they feel it. So these are the two examples. Always answering your question, how do you start these initiatives actually through engagement with the community?
Okay, thank you. The second, the third question is about with open access module, so how it will influence the library collection structure?
Yeah, so I think I briefly mentioned, I just put some thoughts. This is something, you know, still not clear because the flipping to open access is not globally happening, it's not completely happening. If it happens globally, just imagine, you have everything open access available, then what the acquisition librarians are going to do, what subject librarians are going to do, what the people who negotiate are going to do, and are we really need to have catalog of, you know, or the ERM systems, et cetera, et cetera. These are the things we need to think. So that you know, talent available may need to be channelized into the new area of supporting more in open access and open science. Then particularly about library collections, I also mentioned the library subscription budget, you know, transforming into supporting open access publishing and open science. This is globally happening. So these are the two answers I have. And then again, library collection, how do we measure and how do we assess our library collections? Again, I mentioned in the a slide, I put some questions. How are we going to measure it in the future? Is it based on cost per use, or is based on how many articles your institution published with your library support? So these are some questions. I may not have a clear answer for that. This is still needs to be evolved.
Yes, that's true. The last question is coming from the online audience. So Joe's, it's a Migo Joe's. Yes, the question is, I think it's about the definition. It's open access policy, research data management policy, and open science policy. So are they differ from each other?
I think so, because open science is a big umbrella, which includes open access to research publications, which includes research data management, open education resources, citizen science, open evaluation, everything. So definitely, but you say if you have an open science policy as an umbrella policy, probably you may not need, you know, I mean, it depends on the institution. If you want, you can have separate policies. But if you have an open science policy as an umbrella policy explaining everything, how your research output be shared, how your research data should be shared, how you have to create open education materials, et cetera, et cetera. Then you may not need a separate policies. So these all are components of open science. So this is how I am seeing it. I hope I answered that question clearly.
Mm-hmm. So if any online audience, if you have any more questions, you can just turn on your video and the microphone so that you can have a direct talking with Dr. Vijay. So anybody can have any more questions for Dr. Vijay today's report?
So I think there are two questions on Q&A.
Yes, one is, yes.
Will you receive recording after the session? So I think you will share with them. Then second is, okay, you already asked that, Miguel Joseph. Okay,
yes, I think some audience, they need your slides and also the recording videos.
Sure, you can share with the participants.
Oh, that's great. Does anybody have any more questions? Okay, so if you don't have any more questions, we just thank you, Dr. Vijay. As a final part, I'd like to give a summary for this session. I think research libraries should not just follow this trend, but also closely shape it as well. This requires ongoing reflection and research into library roles in this new era. This requires a fundamental shift in terms of structures, tasks, and also skills. It also will change the idea of the library collection, I think. Library should and have to adapt to get engaged and manage to become the most important connection for the scholarly community. At last, we would like to thank you again, Dr. Vijay, for your very informative and stimulating contributions, and all the participants for the valuable discussion and stay online with us today. We will see you again at WAL Spotlight next lecture in June. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.